All right, good morning, church. We're going to go ahead and get started with some worship. If you would, let's stand together as we start.
Presence in our life. Father, we thank you for your goodness toward us. Father, we thank you for the strength that you provide. Father, for the healing, Lord, that you have provided. Father, we thank you for the ability, Lord, to be here this morning. Lord, and we just pray now, Lord, that the name of Jesus would be glorified. Father, we pray that we come, Lord, as your children, Lord, today, and we worship in spirit and truth. Lord, trusting you, believing you, Lord, just as Noah did, he believed God. Father, Lord, we pray today that we come. And Lord, our statement of faith is that we believe God. We trust in Jesus, and we will walk and follow him all the days of our life, believing him for our needs, believing him for our salvation, believing him for the deliverance that he has promised. Father God, Lord, we ask now, Lord, that you be with those that are a part of our church family that are not able to be here. Lord, because of the pandemic, Lord, because of those that are sick, and Lord, for those that are in the hospital, Lord, seeking to recover from sickness. Father, we praise you for all that you have done. Lord, we just look forward to what you're going to do. And Father, we praise the name of Jesus for it. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. God bless you. We're so glad you're able to be in God's house this morning here at Roxy Baptist Church. And we do pray that you come expecting a blessing. You know, when I was thinking about that this week as I was studying God's Word, Matthew 6, 33. Do you remember what Matthew 6, 33 says? Do you remember what it says? Matthew 6, 33. Think about this. Now we talk about worry and being concerned. And Jesus shared the Word with him. He said, do you remember? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and what? His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Now, folks, I want you to understand something. You know what? I want to tell you, we're going to find out a little bit about it today. And I want you to understand there is an information war going on. And people want us to believe, you know what? That I know that there are a lot of terrible things going on in this world right now. But folks, I want you to understand something. I believe with all my heart, God is still in control. I believe that. There are a lot of things the devil is stirring in people's hearts, and they're carrying on and doing and living like that, but it ain't stopped God from reigning on his throne. And we need to be sold out in that, and we just need to believe. And you know what? I want to tell you something. We need to turn our eyes away from this world and what it's doing, because it causes us to worry. I know it does me. Sometimes it causes me to think about things maybe that I ought not think about. And just to believe that, you know what, this is bigger than God can handle. But I want you to understand something, folks, it's not. God is still in control. You know what, some of the hardest times in our life is like it was in the day of Noah. It's to be able to trust God. You know what, right now I want you to understand, we're just like Noah's, folks. Noah and his people, we're in the ark, we're secure. We are floating around, Brother Chance, sometimes. You know what? It may be a little turbulent. But folks, I want you to understand, we're resting in his arms. He is in charge. And one day, just as it was for Noah, guess what? That ship's going to run aground on Mount Ararat. And folks, one day, God's going to say, come out. Or Jesus, go get my children. I think we're getting closer to that every single day. Folks, what I want you to do today is you come to praise and worship the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. I want you to turn your eyes toward heaven. I want you to believe within your heart. I want you to know it within all your fiber, all your being, that God is in control. And you know what? He's going to take care of his people just as he did for Noah. He has provided a way of deliverance for you and I through Jesus Christ, his Son. And folks, we need to trust in that. We need to trust in that. This morning, I'm so glad you're in God's house. I do want to ask you as we come together this morning to pray about a couple of things. Continue to pray for our church. We was in our deacons meeting this morning, and we just believe that God is leading us as a church family on, it's March 7th, actually. It's the first Sunday in March, March the 7th. Folks, we're going to open back up. We're going to be doing church Sunday school at 10 o'clock. We're going to be doing church service at 11. We're going to be doing Sunday night discipleship at 6. We're going to be doing church service at 7. And then on Wednesday night at 6 o'clock, we'll be meeting for prayer meeting as well. So we're going to be back on campus. So, folks, you pray that as everything begins to open back up, as things get going, folks, that here at our church, that God's going to bless it, that God's going to use it. And I want to encourage you to do this. Let somebody else know that that's what we're church home, we let them know we want them here at Roxy Baptist Church, folks. We want to see God's people come together, and we want to see them worship the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And folks, I'm going to tell you something. You know, the folks that might not come for me might would come for you if you'll ask them. And then they'll get here, and they'll see they can be a part of the family of God right here at Roxy Baptist Church. So please, invite somebody and look forward. But don't want you to not to quit coming between now and then, because we'll meet every Sunday at 11. And again, online on Wednesday night at 6, okay? Wednesday night at 6. And if you can't watch it at 6, guess what? You can watch it there sometimes after. I know my mother-in-law, last Sunday, she's not able to go to her church right now, so she watched our church service from last Sunday online during the worship hour last week. And then, of course, later today, sometimes our church service will post online, and you can watch that as well. We're working on some ideas about trying to get our internet service up here to where it's strong enough that we can actually go maybe live streaming at some point and some different things. So be praying about that. And pray for Vic finished up his treatments this week. We want to pray for him that God will just work in his life. For Shane, as he's going to be approaching a time of having to go back for his PET scan, so pray for him. Remember Mr. Billy. He's doing so well, we tend to forget that he has been praying about some things in his life, dealing with his cancer on his lungs. So we're going to just know that God is in control there. So continue to pray for him. Ricky had his his bone marrow transplant last Tuesday, and in that everything went well. He's been doing good. So continue to pray for him as God works in his life to heal him over the leukemia that he's struggling with. But man, folks, I want to tell you something. God is good. God is good. And you know what? I hope and pray that you believe that. But as we get started this morning, I just pray that your focus would be upon God and what he's done for you. And then not only that, what God is doing.
Brother James. All right, let's stand as we continue to worship.
Hey.
heart's always hunger for. Oh, our heart's always hunger for. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for today and for allowing us to worship. And I pray, God, that you are pleased with what you've heard today. Lord, may this be our prayer that you are all that our heart hungers for. Lord, that every day that we wake up, our choice is to seek you first. That we may start every day thinking about you and end every day thinking about you. So, Lord, our life would be more than just the day-to-day things that happen to us. But, Lord, that we would think about the future we have with you. God, we praise you and everything that you've done for us. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Father God, Lord, we're just so grateful. Lord, did you allow us? Oh, Father God, Lord, not only allow us, but Lord, you call us into your presence. Wow. What a great thing to hear from the God of heaven, the God Almighty, the one that Moses said, who should I say sent me? And the only one that declared, the only one that had the power to declare, you say that the I Am sent you. Father God, Lord, you have called us into your presence. And Father, we thank you so much that, Lord, we can, yes, dance with joy. Because, Lord, we can speak of your love. Father God, Lord, we can feel your love. Lord, we can experience your love. And as Paul wrote, Lord, you have given us your spirit. It's a guarantee upon the promises that you have made us. Though this world may shake, Lord, though we may get tired, Lord, though we may find ourselves weak, Father God, Lord, we can trust in the promises that you have made us. Father God, Lord, we rejoice today. And Lord, yes, I do pray. Lord, that as the world might see the light within us, then too, they may begin to join in the dancing and find the joy that we now experience. Father God, we praise the name of Jesus today for all that he's done. Yet, Father God, for all he's going to do. Lord, speak now. In Jesus' name. Amen. Wow, folks, I tell you what, boy, if that don't get you going, I don't know what will. Woo! Make me want to have that hallelujah moment. I'm telling you, sometimes it's just unexplainable, right? Sometimes in life, we don't know what's going on. We don't understand. You know, it's kind of like one of those weeks this week in our life. You know what? A stress to be impressed. And we're going to be looking again in the life of Noah as we finish up Noah today. And then we're going to move on to Gideon next. So, man, get ready. Get ready as we begin to talk about the stress that we're in and how God uses that to impress upon us his love for us, his power in our life, his work in our life, his delivering power in our life. But not only that, to the onlookers, to those that look at our life and how they see that God is working in our life and how God is redeeming us, but then yet how God is keeping his promises. You know, I want you to understand something, folks. We are definitely in an information war. We're definitely where one group of folks wants you to believe that what they're saying is the truth, and another group wants to tell you that something else is the truth. But folks, remember this. There are not two truths. There's only one. And I want you to understand this, that we know in the Scripture that the devil is the deceiver. We know he is the father of all lies. He does not speak truth. And those that speak things that are in common with the devil, get this, folks, they're liars. Because see, there's only one truth. And if it does not agree with God's word, guess what? It's not. It's not true. This is the truth. Now, here's the thing. I can choose to agree with God and follow the truth, or I can choose to agree with the world and follow the lie, and it's going to be up to me. It's up to you. It's up to the world. But I want to tell you something. Yes, I can choose how I want to live and what I do, but I can't choose the consequences of the choice that I've made. We see here in this picture in Noah, and we see in Noah's life where God, again, I want to remind you, the idea of what Noah had to deal with, it says that God said, he called Noah, and he said, Noah, I want you to understand, get this, my spirit shall not strive with man forever, for man's heart now is continually turned toward, or his intent of his heart is continually toward evil. And it grieved God so to the point that God said he was sorry that he had made man. And then we know what the scripture says. Praise God for that. Hallelujah. He said, and then, but, Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And we understand why that was. Well, I want to tell you now, as I said, our week has been kind of strange around the Wallace house and the Wallace family. First off, you know what? Sometimes when you got to do things, it kind of makes you fearful, makes you afraid. You know, my daughter, she'll be 29 this year. And she was one of the, well, actually, take that back, she'll be 30. Woo! I just added a year on to her. She probably wouldn't like that, would she? Took one away, she'd probably like that. But I want you to understand something. She was terrified of the doctor. Do you know why? She associated the doctor with shots. She was terrified. And then I want you to understand something. But a doctor is good, right? But because she had to have an experience of getting a shot at the doctor, no, bad, afraid, fearful, guess what? My grandson Gatlin had the same attitude. He's got that same attitude toward the doctor. Well, this week he got a cough he couldn't get rid of. Of course, they had to go get tested, you know, for the COVID. Negative. So they had to do it, but man, he was terrified because you know what he wanted? He didn't want, number one, he didn't want to be tested for COVID. Number two, guess what? He didn't want a shot. So when he went to the doctor, he was terrified. And Brittany's in there reasoning with him. And I want you to understand, this is how it works sometimes in life. People try to reason with you. The world will try to reason with you. Instead of saying, hey, listen up. You're sick. You need to be here. The doctor's going to help you. This is good. She began to reason with him, like all good parents do. And she says, Doc, Gatlin, listen, son, you need to be here. We're going to find out. You're not getting a shot. We are just going to get you some medicine. So he says, okay, Mama. He calms down. The doctor walks in the door. Dr. Shan, if you know him, he got that big mustache, big old dude. He walks in the door, and he's always full of life. Generally got on these bright yellow Crocs. And guess what happens? Gatlin looks at him and says, we just here to get some medicine. Now, I want you to understand something. Wow. But he was looking and speaking to who? Who? The doctor. And then to Mama for that fact, but I want you to understand, who knew better what this five-year-old needed? He did? Or that doctor? You see, I wanted to paint you this picture. Who knows better what we need today? Me, you, or God? Come on. God does. He said, seek ye first, what? The kingdom of God. You know what, folks? If we want to get to the point that we learn to quit worrying, we got to quit listening to the 5 years old of this world. Hallelujah. Hey, what about it? I mean, I know some grown folks that act like five-year-olds. Do y'all? Woo, bunch of them. Guess what? They have no faith. They have no belief in a God that is almighty. You know what? I'm going to tell you something. And when the I am speaks up, they're going to shake and tremble like they have never shook before. I'm going to tell you something to one of those folks that says, one of those folks that's headed for a great fall is all those people. And you've heard them. I ain't afraid of nothing. You know what you can go on and do? Check, they put the mark on them. They crazy. Because I want to tell you something. There are things in this world that will scare you and make you afraid. I know that Mr. Howard and Ms. Gale has experienced that with health issues, but also in the loss of a son. There's things that can make you afraid, aren't they? When I had a child that was sick beyond what daddy could do, I was afraid. I want you to understand it's human to have moments when we're afraid. When you had to send your son back, no bigger than that, to let them open his heart up, you were afraid, wasn't you? Folks, I want you to understand, but God knows us better than we do. But I want to tell you something. When he allows us to experience these things in our life, he's going to use them for his glory. He's going to use them for his glory. I want to remind you of Paul's word in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 20 through 22. Because you know what? So many times we forget, and I've been trying to get this through to you, and this has been my go-to scripture here of late, and I want you to listen again. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 20 through 22, and to listen what God said. Because see, you know what? If you're saved in here, you know what I'm talking about. You could raise your hand. I gave my heart to Jesus. But my life since giving my heart to Jesus has not been perfect. It has not went as I wanted it. But see, the five-year-olds in life, they don't want the shots. Five-year-olds in life, they want to skip the shots and go straight to the sucker. Right? But I want you to understand, our God is good and God knows what the end result. And folks, I'm going to tell you something. One day, this vessel that we're riding in, this, and I want to change it. I want you to understand this. That imperfect boat that Noah made was covered on the inside and the outside with pitch, which is, best I can tell, I tried to study all the ideas of pitch, but it's anywhere from tar, where, you know, out of a pine tree sap, or like, well, I'm going to say pine tree now. I mean, you know, I'm talking about, it ain't pine trees over there, it's cypress. It's a lot of cedar trees, a lot of different things, but they got these trees that can produce, or it could be some type of petroleum, maybe even some type of something they got out of the ground. But it was made like a resin. And what they would do is take it and burn it and cook it. And when they cook it, it'd get thicker. And then they'd take it and they'd paint the inside of the ship with this pitch. And then when it dried, it made this thing waterproof. And when they got inside the vessel and it was closed up, when God shut the door on this, folks, I want to tell you something. They were safer than they'd ever been. You hear me? Because guess what? It ain't like this. It ain't like getting in the car with my wife and riding from here to Jackson. My daddy said, you fly low. I want you to understand something, but when you get that idea that God, this vessel, but you know, pitch is like atonement. That is this. Folks, I want you to understand. You're cradled in the arms of God. You are surrounded by Christ's blood. And when I leave this earth, when you leave this earth, the first thing that will be seen of those that are children of God, will get this, will be this. The blood of Jesus. Just like it was in the Passover. When the angel of death went over the houses in that time in Egypt. He was looking for those that were, get this, covered in the blood, and they went past them and on to the house where they were not covered in the blood. And I want you to understand something, folks. That's where we're at. And I want you to understand, we need to quit listening. As much as I love my little grandson, Gatlin, I know he don't like shots. And he don't understand what's good for him. And like I said, he'd rather go straight to the sucker. Didn't matter how much it cost mama or daddy. He wanted the sucker. But you know what's worse than that? Is if he got just medicine. At times, even when he gets the medicine he don't like, guess what? The way it tastes. And then he don't want to take it either. Do you understand the picture here? In Noah's day, you know what? Noah was one of those guys that says, you know what, man? He said, I care about, my eyes are set up on God. That's who I'm believing in. That's who I'm trusting in. He said, I'm going to, even though we know that scripture is New Testament in Matthew, but Noah had agreed within his heart, within his spirit. He said, you know what? I'm not going to worry. He said, you know what, I'm going to cast my eyes and turn my heart toward God, and I'm going to believe Him, for God is good, and I believe God. But I want you to understand, listen again to this, to these words of Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, 22. In all promises of God, in Him, that is Christ, are yes. God would not make you a promise in Jesus that He would renege on. And in Him, amen. Not only is He saying, I'm going to promise you and give you a promise, He said, and it is yes that we're going to do it. It's going to happen. Get this, He says, this is the best part. The amen part, hallelujah. What do you think about that amen? You know what, on this side of earth, I can go through here and tell you, hearts have been broken. Amen? Hearts have been broken. There has been hurt. There has been sorrow. But God says one day, Miss Gail, one day, it's going to come an amen. That when He says, you know what I told you, what I promised you, you ain't going to be heartbroken forever. One day you're going to see little Howard again. Amen. He's going to bring it to completion, the promise that he made you. Though we sorrow now for a little while, one day, for those of us that have lost mothers, for those of us that have lost kinfolks, for children, spouses, for those that have gone on under the Lord's care, under that blood of Jesus, folks, I want to tell you something. There's going to be an amen to it. God says he's going to bring it to completion. You can trust it. Paul said it right here. He was telling them as they accused him of not being truthful. But get this. Look at verse 21 again and listen what it says. And now he who establishes us with you in Christ, he's talking about them, has anointed us in God, who also has sealed us. In other words, God's making a promise. God started something. You know what? God anointed us. God set us apart. And then not only that, now he's sealed us. You know what? You think about that. That insignia ring by the king meant it's a done deal. You can't go back. You know what? That's the best part about it. I love that scripture. It says, you know what? No matter what I do, no matter what I do, guess what? No one, nobody, nothing can pluck me from God's hand. Think about that. Noah, inside the belly of that ark, no, nothing could touch him. Think about that perfect picture. I want you to think about that. And you know what? We know the story of Noah because it says, he said, Noah, I'm going to destroy all this other stuff, but you, your wife, oh, your sons, their wives, I'm going to spare. I'm going to deliver them. You see, I want you to understand something. Noah's example was that idea of what it meant. Of generational trust in the Lord. Now, what that meant was, it didn't mean that all those were perfect. Nope. But it means they were being taught grace. It meant they were being led and fathered by one that trusted in the Lord, and he was showing them. And I want you to understand something, folks. In our life, it's not always perfect. Our children don't always behave perfect. They don't always get the ability just to skate through life. You know what? This week, that was an important experience for my daughter. She got a call the other day that Briggs was at the daycare, and she needed to come get him and take him to the doctor. He stuck a rock in his ear. And when they tried to get it, I guess they got a little further. But long story short, they had to take him to the hospital the day after, put him under gas, and get it out. So, a little pee rock. $3,500 later, he'd been delivered. An important experience. Brittany's kept that rock. But let me tell you a story about a child named Brittany, who one day was on her way with her mother and her cousins and her brother to McDonald's. For one reason or another, she picked up a rock. And she stuck it up her nose. We still ain't figured out why. And this was the day her mom decided and she wasn't going to comb her hair. She still had on her sleep clothes. And had to fall off up in the doctor's office. With a little girl with a rock in her nose. But understand something, the panic was so much she didn't even realize what she had on. It was after it was all over and she got home, she looks in the mirror and goes, I can't believe it. Do you understand how easy it is to be distracted when those things that you love are in danger? You can turn your attention to them more than you think you can. So many times life gets so busy, we forget to pray for our children. We get to pray for our grandbabies. But folks, I want you to understand something. In a moment's notice, it can be urgent. And I want you to be praying for your children every day. I mean, I want you to put them on your prayer list. I want you to pray for your children. I want you to pray for your grandchildren. You know what? If you got children and ain't married yet, you begin to pray for their spouses right now. You're going to need it. It's just the way it is. We don't always see things eye to eye. Hardest thing for me to ever do was to, you know, I told Brittany what to do forever, and Daddy said it. Guess what? She did it. But now she's got a new leader, her husband. We don't always see things eye to eye. I think Daddy is important. You know what I mean? I want you to understand that. I want you to believe that. And I want you to get that idea that, you know what, that God is the one that puts the stamp on things and says it's important. Pray that they would be sealed, that they would be sealed by His blood, that they would be protected, that it's a done deal. So that you could share in this one thing. Listen what He says again. And given us the Spirit in our hearts as a guarantee. Joe, if you will, that last song that Brother Chance and Molly sung there, put it back, that one, the verse, I guess that was the chorus, is that what that was? The second part of the chorus, yeah. I could sing of your love forever. I believe if the whole world were to see, they would start dancing. That part? The bridge, there you go. Look at this. Folks, I want you to understand something. Oh, I feel like dancing. How many, you know, when's the last time you felt like dancing? Molly, you still need them dancing lessons? It's foolishness, I know. What does 1 Corinthians say, folks? Think about this. You know what? The cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those who are being saved, it is the power of God. Wow. Now I want you to understand. You know what? So it's foolish, man. You go on believe that if you want to. But urge your children to understand. Urge them to understand what it means. But when the world has seen the what? See, there's got to be a difference. What is that difference? You know how they're going to find it? Matthew 6, 33. What? I know this world is in terrible fix. But I tell you what. In spite of whatever it is, I'm not going to try to find a way around. Right? How many times do we like to try to find the way around? Are you like one of those folks, you see the wreck up ahead, you start punching in your phone looking for the detour? Not us. We're nosy. We go right through the wreck. We're going to wait it out. No. But I want to tell you, sometimes it's like that with God, isn't it? What do we want to do? We want to go around, don't we? How many of you wanted the detour before? God's taking you down the road and you said, Lord, if there was a way, what did Jesus pray? Father God, Lord, if it were possible, please let this cup, what? Pass from me. But Father God, Lord, not my will, but what? Thine. Let me tell you something. Now, Noah had accepted that in his heart. Even though we know that is New Testament, it's from the words of Jesus Christ, Noah had accepted it in his heart. He said, Lord, if this is what you're going to call me to, then Lord, I'll do it. And he went out and he spent those years building that ark, even though he was made to look what? Foolish. Can you imagine if they'd had a party line or had a phone back in them days? Hey, can you believe this? Man, that Noah. I thought he was off his rocker, but I know it now. Because you know what? He is building a boat. And there ain't no water within miles. And it's so big, you couldn't even pull it on a trailer if he had one. He was made to look foolish. You know what? Joe, did it go off or did you take it off? All right, put it back if you don't mind. Because I'm going to be honest with you, I'm in uncharted waters right now. See, he was foolish. When did the world see the light? Come on, somebody say it. And then it was what? But when the world sees the light, I want to remind you, get what this says. Because see, here's this. You got to go back to verse 20 and the latter part of verse 20 of chapter of 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20. Listen to what it says again. For all the promises of God in Him, talking about Christ Jesus, are yes. And in Him are amen, brought to completion. What does it say? To the glory of God. Through who? Through us. I want you to see that. I want you to believe that. That you know what? God is working just like He did in Noah's day, in your life, in my life. He has provided a vessel of transportation for you and I. In one day, it's going to come to rest upon Mount Ararat. You know what? It rained 40 days and 40 nights, right? And the water stayed upon the earth, according to the Scripture, 150 days. And then Noah sent out that dove. And do you remember what it brought back? Huh? Olive branch. He brought back that olive branch. And I want you to understand something. And then they were allowed to go out of the ark, and the first thing that happened, get this, was Noah did this. Praise the Lord, I just went right through this without even moving my paper. But man, I want you to share this with you. I got to get to the right spot. I guess I should have been moving my papers. What was the first thing that Noah did? Do you remember? Listen to what it says in chapter 8. Then God remembered Noah and every living thing and all the animals that were in the ark, and God made the wind to pass over and subside over the waters. Now I want you to think about this. It says that God remembered Noah. But I want you to remember what happened. Get this. I gotta get to the right spot. I guess I should have been paying more attention. Noah made an altar. Noah made an altar. And guess what Noah did? When he made an altar, verse 20 of chapter 8, listen to what it says. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord. And he took every clean animal and every clean bird and offered a burnt offering on the altar. And the Lord smelled a soothing aroma. Then the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground for man's sake, although the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth, nor will I again destroy every living thing as I have done. Folks, I want you to understand this picture here. God has remembered Noah in the ark, and God turned to Noah. And what did he find Noah doing? Still being obedient as he was commanded. And then all of a sudden, guess what? When Noah, can you imagine? Some of you been to the ark, hadn't you? Raise your hand if you've been to the ark thing. You've been there, and it was work, wasn't it? That was a busy day. You had to get up early. I don't know that you ever went to sleep with a boat full of animals. But I want to tell you something. He had to work, so his day was busy. And then all of a sudden it says that when Noah remembered God, but I want you to understand, when Noah was prompted of God's presence, when Noah kind of, because see, you can get distracted, right? We can get distracted. Anybody here ever have busy days? And when we do, we forget what? We're still children of God, but we tend to not be as in communion with God as we would like to be. But in that instance, guess what happens? When we're convicted of it, we say, oh, yes, Father God, Lord. And Noah said, oh, man, look what's happened. This olive branch has come back. God's beginning. God is ready to do something. God is ready to work. I praise him for it. And he goes out and he builds an altar and he praises him. And he prays him. He offers sacrifice. And then God... It says God sensed it. And I want you to understand this. The best interpretation I got of that, you know, sweet smelling aroma, soothing aroma, was this. Get this. God smiled. Noah made God happy. How many of y'all seen Mercy Me? I believe it is. New song, Happy Dance. I'm going to tell you something, that's what we need. A little happy dance. We don't need to be worried about those that are thinking things are foolish. We need to turn our hearts away from that. Brother Joe, go back to that bridge again. Because I want you to understand this. I want you to know, and you know that you know, and I want to remind you of, because I want to share this one verse with, or these two verses, or three verses actually, in Matthew again. Listen to what it says in Matthew chapter 5. Verses 13 through 6, or 16, it says, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled under the foot by men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set up on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand. And it gives light to all who are in the house. There's that family thing. And get this. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works. And go back to this here. Glorify your Father in heaven. What is Paul working for? What did Paul say God was working for? To the glory of God. Through who? Us. See, understand something. That we have to have that. We have to let our light shine so that others might see it, that they may glorify our Father in heaven. Then you know what? I want you to understand there's this act of obedience. You know what? God's love is unconditional. How many people believe that? I don't have to do anything to earn His love. But folks, I want to tell you something. When you want to experience God's best blessings, now that's the way I like to say it, best blessings. You know what? You can't understand how I was so glad to hear that song and knowing my message today and hearing some of the same thoughts that I'm having right there in that message, to know that God has given me one of His best blessings. To know that God is working in us to make sure that the people are hearing what he wants you to hear. But I want you to understand, get this, folks, it rains on the just and the unjust. So sometimes those that are lost in the world, that are thinking it's all foolishness, they're enjoying God's sunshine and they're enjoying God watering the ground just like everybody else is. But you want to tell you what? The best blessings of God are part of this. When you're obedient. See, all the folks in Noah's day, they enjoyed all the things and they went along as if nothing was going wrong. They were enjoying life. And then, uh-oh. Guess what happened? God says, it's time. I'm ready. My patience is not going to strive forever with man. It's time to call to account. And then all of a sudden, the best blessings, because of those of Noah and his obedience to God, it says he found grace from the Lord. Do you understand that? And that's why it's so important. Do you know somebody today that needs grace? I hope you do. You know why? That's all of us. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Again, I want to leave you with these examples because remember this. Remember this. You remember last week I shared with you in Acts about Paul and Agrippa asking him, he said, what are you trying to do? You're trying to convince me? You're trying to get me to be one of you? Do you remember Paul's words? Paul said, not only you. Not only you, but all. I want you to experience what I've experienced, all of you. Except for what? These chains. He said, I'm being chained right now for Christ, basically. I want you to know what it's like not to be chained. I want you to know what it's like to be free. For on the road to Damascus, the whole story tells us, Paul was set free. How many of you in your families today, you might know somebody that needs to be free? Well, I want to tell you this. Your example needs to be that of Noah. What was it? Genesis 6. Verse 8 is where it all started for Noah. This is what Noah saw. Again, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. What did the people see? The people that witnessed Noah's life, this is what they saw. Get this, Genesis 6, 9. This is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man, perfect in his generation. Noah walked with God. And to sum it up, Genesis 6, 22. What did God see? You know what God saw? Get this. Thus Noah did according to all God had commanded him. So he did. If one day the plan that we have of deliverance is going to rest high on the mountain of God in heaven that needs to be written. It needs to be carried out as the plan that God commanded. Wow. You know, we have lowered the standard an awful lot today. We've changed it from what God said to what man said. Now, God's grace is sufficient. No doubt about that. But remember what the standard is. Be ye holy, for I am holy. Doesn't that change things? Matthew 6, 36 again. Seek ye first the righteousness of God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness. Let me quote it correctly. Sometimes I want to redneck it. I can't help it. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness. Folks, that's the way we are, but we, you know, we want to adjust it. We want to change it. We want to do it. But I want you to understand something. Set your eyes upon God's kingdom. Set your eyes upon what he's doing and yield to his righteousness. Because see, one day when we are, when our vessel has to rest upon Mount Ararat, I want you to understand something. Folks, when it has to come to an end, if we're going to ever get to that greatest peak in life, it's going to be because we're in his arms because of what Jesus done for us. I pray that you know him as Lord and Savior today. If you don't, today's the day. Maybe there's never been a time in your life when you've said, I never had to admit I was a sinner. I've never come before the Lord and say, Father God, Lord, forgive me. You know, Lord, I want you to be Lord of my life. But today's the day. I pray God does his work today.